Hi, my name is Dr. Rich Miller and I'm the fish vet. Today we're presented with a school of Altum angels. They've been growing for the last 2 years really well, but lately one of them has stopped eating and has stopped eating for about a month, and we're here to investigate the reason for that. So we've done some water quality testing, and what we've found is the pH is sitting at around close to 5, and the ammonia is at 5 parts per million. Well, the ammonia is not going to be an issue at this stage because the pH is quite low, so it means that the toxic version of ammonia, the unionized ammonia, is not in its, there's not a lot of the toxic form present, so that means that that's going to be fine. But the pH sitting at 5, it may be an issue or it may not. The literature says that Altums tend to live in pH of between 5 to 6, so we'll investigate the reason. We've got one fish that has sort of been showing neurological signs and hasn't eaten in so long that the sort of humane thing to do for him was to euthanize him. So we can do some lab testing and show you the results of that.
So here we're looking at a histological section of a fish that died. We're basically cutting a very thin section through the throat area. Here you can see the pharyngeal teeth. If we zoom in, we can find these little light brown shapes, and these are not part of the fish. They appear to be some sort of foreign body with marked inflammation around it. And you can see two populations of cells. The thinner ones are the fibrous tissue, and the darker pink cells are your phagocytes, which are the immune cells that come in to try to eat up and get rid of this foreign material. The differential diagnoses list for these foreign bodies would be maybe a fungal, algal, or some other foreign body. And if we go and have a look at the stomach here, you can see similar reaction with similar foreign body material. This is not typical for a fungus, because you can see here there are hairs sort of sticking out of these shafts. So now we're going to examine the stomach to see what they've been eating and whether this has anything to do with what we're seeing in the inflamed areas. What we're going to do is we're going to look at the lumen of the stomach, which is what's inside of the stomach that it's eaten. And we can see that these structures here resemble what was embedded in the throat and in the stomach wall. So this makes us want to investigate what the owner actually is feeding the fish. So I've asked the owner to submit samples of the food. And the first food item we're looking at here is a shrimp. And you can see here is the head and the body. And here are some things that resemble a little bit of what we're seeing down the microscope. But these structures here, although it resembles what was seen embedded in the stomach and in the throat, it doesn't quite fit in terms of the diameter and the shape. So next we're going to look at the brine shrimp. Again, looking at the body, you can see that the legs are starting to taper towards the end, and there are no real structures that are running sort of perpendicular to the long shaft. So this it could be a possibility, but it doesn't quite fit. Now we're looking at the red worm. Here's the head, and here's the body and the tail. And there's nothing in here that resembles what we saw histologically. And now we're moving over to a pupa of a mosquito larvae. And you can see it's got very smooth exoskeleton and no such harmful hairs. But if you look at the younger aged mosquito larvae, you can see that they do have these hairs coming out. Here, especially at the anal segment, there are these brushes of hairs, and they do look very sinister. Close and have a specific look at these hairs, they do have these lateral projections coming out of the bristles. They're very long, and they are the right diameter and length of those seen histologically. So here's the histology section, just to remind and recap what we were seeing previously. So in the throat here, you can see these huge amount of host reaction with the pink cells and these long brown structures, which is the exoskeleton part of our mosquito larvae. Now, mosquito larvae are generally harmless food, and it's normally commonly fed to pretty much any most aquarium fish in the world. Why is it and how does it happen that these bristles from these mosquito larvae can actually penetrate the mucosa of the throat and the stomach? So what we're going to do next is to investigate why these organs may have been compromised. This is a new condition that I've never encountered before in my practice, and I was unable to find anything in the literature that describes why mosquito larvae can cause such severe esophagitis and gastritis. This has required me to do some investigative work to find out what the possible conditions in the aquarium that may have predisposed our angels to this disease. So this made me review our water quality parameters. I noticed ammonia in our water, and this was at 5 milligrams per liter. At this level and at this pH, it is not toxic to fish. So it made me think about why it's in an established tank that we get these levels of ammonia. It should normally be reading zero if the biofilter is alive and working correctly. And the most common cause for biofilters to sort of crash or die back is due to a pH drop, so acidic water conditions. Now, remember our pH here, when we tested it, was at 5.0. So it is possible that this pH could have dropped below the 5, starting to harm our bacteria in the biofilter. So to find out why this is happening, we're going to open up the biofilter to see what is actually inside it. So here we've lifted up the top and drained it, and we can see in this filter there is the initially it's the mechanical filter that traps all the debris that's in the tank. The next layer is the biofilter. You can see it's made of sponge, and there's still a little bit of slime on the surface, indicating that the bacteria is still living and still present. And next, what we can see underneath all this is peat. Now, peat is normally used to lower the pH of the water. The owner told us that he was using two types of peat, so we obtained samples of both types to see what effects it'll have on the pH of the water. What we did was we minced up the peat into different distilled waters, and we soaked it overnight at room temperature, and we used a probe to test what the pH was at the conclusion of the trial. And here's what we found in our table. So here's what we found. With one type of the peat, it dropped the pH to 4.1, and the other type of peat, it dropped the pH down to 3.95. Now that we've tested the peat and found elevated levels of ammonia in an established tank, we can safely assume that the pH of this water has dropped to below 4 between water changes. Here's my theory of what's happening in these altums. In humans who get gastric reflux, it's the acid that comes up from the stomach that causes erosion and ulceration of the esophagus. So likewise, what I'm proposing in this case is that the constant acidic conditions from the water is causing damage to the lining of the esophagus and throat of the fish. With the compromised mucosal integrity of the throat, it allows these sort of exoskeleton and these barbs and spikes from these mosquito larvae to pierce through and cause this severe granulomatous esophagitis. To put it simply, these fish have very inflamed, sore throats. The degree of acidification generated by peat will depend on the water quality parameters of your water source. When you're deciding to use peat, it's very important that you test it in a bucket of aquarium water to see what effect it'll have on your water quality conditions before you use it in your aquarium. Here's the advice I gave to the owner on how to manage this situation. Number one was to make sure you increase the pH to between 5.5 to 6.5, ensuring it does not decrease below 5. And then avoiding live foods or things that contain this tough exoskeleton from the diet for approximately 1 to 2 months to give the throat and stomach time to heal. And instead, feed it a proprietary make of food that, such as fish flakes, that is high in protein and easy to swallow and digest. So after correcting the pH of the water and avoiding live foods, the fish have recovered. So this supports our theory that the combination of low pH plus live foods, and in this case mosquito larvae, has caused this disease. If you have any other theories, make sure you write your comments below, because I've been very interested to hear what your thoughts are. Thank you for watching. Make sure you subscribe to get updates of our future videos, and have a fantastic week.